What exactly is learning? In ordinary language, the term is applied to many different situations: the development of new skills, the acquisition of new knowledge, and much more. Early psychologists who studied learning were concerned specifically with uncovering a set of uniform principles that would explain the process of learning, no matter what type of learning is examined and no matter what species is doing the learning. An ambitious goal, to be sure. This early work on learning contributed to the foundations of behaviorism, a school of thought that viewed learning as having only to do with purely observable behaviors and nothing whatsoever to do with any unobservable or internal mental processes. Perhaps the simplest form of learning to have been demonstrated across species and intensively studied by behaviorists is habituation, the decline in an organism's response to a stimulus once the stimulus has become familiar. Imagine living in an apartment on a busy city street. At first, you find the traffic noise is distracting and obnoxious. After you've lived in the apartment for a while, though, the noises bother you much less, and eventually, you won't notice them at all. At this point, you've become habituated to the noises. Habituation produces a huge benefit. We want to pay attention to unfamiliar stimuli, because these may signal danger or indicate some unexpected opportunity. But at the same time, we don't want to waste time scrutinizing every stimulus we run across. So, how do we manage to be suitably selective? The answer is habituation. This simple form of learning essentially guarantees that we ignore inputs we're already familiar with and have found to be inconsequential and focus instead on the novel ones. Just as important as habituation is its opposite, dishabituation, an increase in responding caused by change in something familiar. So, the city dweller who's seemingly oblivious to traffic noise will notice if the noise suddenly stops. Thus, dishabituation serves the function of calling attention to newly arriving and potentially useful information, just as habituation serves the function of helping you ignore old news. Other forms of learning provide a bit more information, in particular, associations among events. In fact, associations are the basis for powerful types of learning across many different species.
What are you doing?
One example is classical conditioning. In experiments credited with the discovery of classical conditioning, a Russian physiologist named Ivan Pavlov rang a bell and then gave a dog some food. After repeating this pairing multiple times, the dog eventually treated the bell as a signal for food and began salivating in anticipation of the treat. The dog food in Pavlov's experiment is the unconditioned stimulus, or US, because it elicits an unconditioned response, or UR. That is, without any kind of training or teaching, the stimulus produces a natural instinctual reaction. In Pavlov's case, the food automatically makes the dog drool. Other examples of unconditioned stimuli include loud noises that startle us, or a hot shower that produces muscle relaxation. On the other hand, a conditioned stimulus produces a conditioned response. A conditioned stimulus, CS, is a signal that has no importance to the organism until it is paired with something that does have importance. For example, in Pavlov's experiment, the bell is the conditioned stimulus. Before the dog has learned to associate the bell with the presence of food, hearing the bell means nothing to the dog. However, after multiple pairings of the bell with the presentation of food, the dog starts to drool at the sound of the bell. This drooling in response to the bell is the conditioned response. Although it can be confusing, the conditioned response is almost always the same as the unconditioned response. In this example, drooling. However, it is called the conditioned response because it is conditional on, or depends on, being paired with the conditioned stimulus. For example, the bell. To help make this clearer, consider becoming really hungry when you see the logo for a fast food restaurant. There's a good chance that you'll start salivating. Although it is the actual eating of the food that normally produces the salivation, simply seeing the restaurant's logo can trigger the same reaction. Another example outside of the lab that you're probably very familiar with involves your alarm clock. If you're like most people, waking up early makes you unhappy. In this case, waking up early produces a natural sensation of tension or discomfort. Rather than waking up on your own, though, you likely have an alarm clock that plays a tone to wake you. Before setting your alarm to that particular tone, let's imagine you had neutral feelings about it. That is, the tone had no prior meaning to you. However, now that you use it to wake up every morning, you psychologically pair that tone with your feelings of tension in the morning. After enough pairings, this tone will automatically produce your natural response of tension or discomfort. Thus, this linkage between the unconditioned stimulus, waking up early, and the conditioned stimulus, the tone, is so strong that the unconditioned response, feeling tense, will become a conditioned response. For example, hearing the tone at any point in the day, whether waking up or walking down the street, will make you feel tense. Learning doesn't take place all at once with classical conditioning. Instead, the learning is gradual, and the strength of the conditioned response slowly grows as the organism experiences more and more pairings of the conditioned and unconditioned stimulus. Once the CSUS relationship is solidly established, though, the conditioned stimulus can be used in other procedures to establish other conditioned stimuli. For example, by using food as the unconditioned stimulus, we can first condition a dog to salivate whenever it hears a bell. Once this is done, we can add a light and follow that with the sound of the bell, without ever introducing the food. After enough of these pairings, the light itself will trigger salivation. In this setting, the light has become a signal for the bell, which we've already established as a signal for the appearance of food. This sequence is called second-order conditioning, a procedure in which a neutral stimulus, here the light, is paired with some already established CS, like the bell. In Pavlov's early experiments, animals were trained with a particular CS, the sound of a bell, for example, and then later tested with that same stimulus. But Pavlov understood that life outside the lab is more complicated. Because of variation in the natural environment, animals must be able to respond to stimuli that aren't identical to the original CS. Otherwise, the animals may obtain no benefit from their earlier learning. It's not surprising, therefore, that different species all show a pattern called stimulus generalization. That is, they respond to a range of stimuli provided that these stimuli are similar enough to the original CS. Here's an example. A dog might be conditioned to respond to a bell with a particular pitch. When later tested on, that dog will respond most strongly if the test bell has the same pitch. But the dog will also respond, although a bit less strongly, to sounds a few notes higher or lower. The dog will also respond to sounds even higher or lower than that, but the response will be weaker still. In general, the greater the difference between the new stimulus and the original CS, the weaker the CR will be. In addition to being able to generalize stimuli, organisms are also able to discriminate between different stimuli. The phenomenon of discrimination is easy to demonstrate. An experiment might, for example, use a boat horn, a loud boat horn, as the unconditioned stimulus. This stimulus reliably produces a startle response when it's sounded. In the first part of the procedure, a red warning light is paired with the boat horn. And after a few pairings, this stimulus will reliably produce a conditioned response. You'll tense your muscles whenever the light appears. Once this CR is established, we proceed to the next step. Now, we intersperse trials pairing the red light and horn with other trials in which a new stimulus, say an orange light, is presented with no US, no boat horn. In this setup, you're likely to generalize at first by tensing up in response to both the red light, technically referred to as the CS+, and the orange light, the CS-. As the training continues, however, trials pairing the red light and horn, mixed with the trials presenting the orange light alone, you'll learn to discriminate and will tense up only when you see the red light. After classically conditioning a particular response, the response can also be eliminated if the conditioned stimulus is presented repeatedly without the unconditioned stimulus. This effect is called extinction. For example, if Pavlov kept ringing the bell but never gave the dog any food afterwards, eventually the dog's conditioned response, salivating, would no longer happen when it heard the conditioned stimulus, the bell, because the bell would no longer be a predictor of food. Extinction is important for many reasons. For one thing, it's the basis for some therapies that clinical psychologists use to eliminate maladaptive and unwanted behaviors. Take the example of a person who has a debilitating fear of spiders. One approach might include systematic exposure to spiders, whereas initially the person has a CR, for example, extreme fear, every time he or she sees the CS, for example, the spider. After repeatedly being shown pictures of spiders in neutral conditions, pretty soon, the CS no longer predicts the CR. That is, the person doesn't have the fear reaction when seeing spiders, having learned that spiders no longer serve as a cue for that fear. Here, repeated exposure to spiders without an adverse consequence causes extinction. But extinction does not necessarily destroy the original learning. Imagine you strongly associate the smell of chalkboards with the agony of middle school detention. Now, imagine after years of encountering chalkboards, the smell of them no longer recalls the agony of detention, an example of extinction. However, one day after entering a new building for the first time, you suddenly catch a whiff of a chalkboard, and wham! The agony of detention returns. This is called spontaneous recovery. Following a lapse in exposure to the conditioned stimulus after extinction has occurred, sometimes re-exposure to the conditioned stimulus, for example, the smell of chalkboards, can evoke the conditioned response again, for example, the agony of detention. Another interesting effect of classical conditioning can occur when we ingest drugs. That is, when a drug is taken, it can be associated with the cues that are present at the same time. For example, rooms, odors, drug paraphernalia. In this regard, if someone associates a particular smell with the sensation induced by the drug, whenever that person smells the same odor afterward, it may cue responses, physical or emotional, related to the drug itself. But drug cues have an even more interesting property. They elicit responses that often compensate for the upcoming effect of the drug. For example, morphine itself suppresses pain. However, if someone is used to taking morphine, a cue that signals the drug is coming soon can actually make the person more sensitive to pain. Because the person knows a pain suppressant will soon be administered, the body becomes more sensitive, anticipating that the drug will soon take care of it. Remarkably, such conditioned compensatory responses in turn decrease the impact of the drug on the body because the body has become more sensitive to pain. This conditioned compensatory response has many implications. For instance, a drug user will be most tolerant to the drug in the presence of cues that have been associated with it. This is because these cues elicit compensatory responses. As a result, overdose is not always due to an increase in dosage, but instead can happen when taking the drug in a new place without the familiar cues, which would have otherwise allowed the user to tolerate the drug. Conditioned compensatory responses, which include heightened pain sensitivity and decreased body temperature, among others, might also cause discomfort, thus motivating the drug user to continue usage of the drug to reduce them. This is one of several ways that classical conditioning might be a factor in drug addiction and dependence. So, as you can see, classical conditioning is a powerful explanation for how we learn. However, there is a second form of associative learning that has also been shown to explain learning across many different species. First studied by Edward Thorndike and later extended by B.F. Skinner, the second type of associative learning is known as instrumental or operant conditioning. This type of conditioning, or learning, occurs when a behavior is associated with the occurrence of a significant event. In the best-known example, a rat in a laboratory learns to press a lever in a cage, called a Skinner box, to receive food. Because the rat has no natural association between pressing the lever and getting food, the rat has to learn this connection. At first, the rat may simply explore its cage, climbing on top of things, burrowing under things in search of food. Eventually, while poking around its cage, the rat accidentally presses the lever, and a food pellet drops in. This voluntary behavior is called an operant behavior because it operates on the environment. That is, it is an action that the animal itself makes. Once the rat recognizes that it receives a piece of food every time it presses the lever, the behavior of lever pressing becomes reinforced. That is, the food pellets serve as reinforcers because they strengthen the rat's lever pressing behavior. In a parallel example, imagine that you're playing a street racing video game. As you drive through one city course multiple times, you try a number of different streets to get to the finish line. On one of these trials, you discover a shortcut that dramatically improves your overall time. You've learned this new path through operant conditioning. That is, by engaging with your environment, you performed a sequence of behaviors that was positively reinforced. You found the shortest distance to the finish line. And now that you've learned how to drive this course, you will perform that same sequence of driving behaviors, just as the rat presses on the lever, to receive your reward of a faster finish. Importantly, operant conditioning research studies how the effect of a behavior influences the probability it will occur again. For example, the effects of the rat's lever-pressing behavior, that is, receiving a food pellet, influences the probability that it will keep pressing the lever. According to Thorndike's law of effect, when a behavior has a positive or satisfying effect or consequence, it's likely to be repeated. However, when a behavior has a negative, that is, painful or annoying consequence, it's less likely to be repeated in the future. Effects that increase behaviors are referred to as reinforcers, and effects that decrease them are referred to as punishers. A reinforcer, though, can be either positive or negative. Positive reinforcement obviously strengthens responses by giving rewards after a desired event, like the rat snack after the lever press, or getting a cookie when you say please. Negative reinforcement is a little trickier. It's what increases a behavior by taking away an aversive or upsetting stimulus. Like, say you get in your car and it does that infernal beeping thing until you fasten your seatbelt. The car is reinforcing your seatbelt wearing by getting rid of that horrible beeping. And it's good because, listen, you should always wear your seatbelt because you don't want to die. But that's an example of a negative reinforcement. It's important to recognize that negative reinforcement is not the same thing as punishment. Punishment decreases a behavior, but negative reinforcement instead removes the punishing event to increase a behavior. Note that behavior extinction, spontaneous recovery, stimulus generalization, and stimulus discrimination are all terms we spoke about in the description of classical conditioning. These terms also apply to operant conditioning. In addition, there are various types of reinforcement schedules that impact operant learning. In fact, all of life is a series of partial or intermittent reinforcements that occur only sometimes. Learning under these conditions takes longer, but it holds up better in the long run and is less susceptible to extinction. Four types of partial reinforcement schedules have been extensively studied. First, fixed ratio schedules reinforce behavior after a set number of responses. Coffee shops, for example, may reward us with a free cup of coffee after every 10 purchases, or a rat might simply receive a food pellet only after 20 lever presses. Once conditioned, animals will pause only briefly after the reinforcement before returning to a high rate of responding. Variable ratio schedules provide reinforcement after a seemingly unpredictable number of responses. This is what slot machine players experience, and it is what makes gambling so hard to extinguish even when it does not produce the desired results. Not surprisingly, variable ratio scales produce consistent and high rates of responding. Fixed interval schedules reinforce the first response after a fixed time period. Animals tend to respond more frequently as the anticipated reward gets closer in time. For example, people check more frequently for the mail as delivery time draws near. Variable interval schedules reinforce the first response after unpredictable and varying time period, like an instructor giving periodic pop quizzes to test your knowledge and make sure you are paying attention in class. This type of reinforcement schedule produces very steady responding. In general, response rates are higher when reinforcement is linked to the number of responses, that is, a ratio schedule, rather than time or interval schedules. But responding is more consistent when reinforcement is unpredictable, a variable schedule, than when it is predictable, a fixed schedule. Now, back in the Skinner box one last time. Not surprisingly, it might take a very long time for a rat to initially press a lever and operant conditioning to commence. I mean, there aren't really food dispensing levers in the natural environment, so operant conditioning behavior requires something called shaping. Maybe you give that rat a little nibble of food each time it gets closer to the lever. Then, after some time, only when it touches the lever, until little by little in a series of successive approximations of the desired behavior, you reward the rat only when they press the lever. Using this technique, people have trained animals to perform all kinds of complex behavior. And many human behaviors probably come about in the same way. As a simple example, how do parents in Western countries teach their children to eat with a spoon and fork? At first, they reward the child, probably with smiles and praise just for holding the spoon. This step soon establishes the grasp the spoon operant.
And at that point, the parents can require a bit more. Now they praise the child just when she touches the food with the spoon. And thanks to this reinforcement, the new operant is quickly established. If the parents continue this way, gradually increasing their expectations, the child will soon successfully be able to eat with a spoon and fork.
Operant conditioning has other real-world applications. One notable example is applied behavioral analysis, or ABA, which relies heavily on operant conditioning to help treat individuals with autism spectrum disorders, especially in improving language deficits. ABA makes extensive use of shaping techniques. That is, ABA therapists offer primary reinforcers as the child reaches progressively closer approximations of certain words and eventually complete sentences. Ivar Lovas and his colleagues pioneered the best-known ABA program, and the research evaluating its effectiveness have been promising. Children who undergo ABA training emerge with better language and intellectual skills than do control groups of children with autism who do not receive ABA training. Because the research does not include random assignment to treatment and control groups, however, the research should not be considered conclusive. It's possible that the children in the experimental group had higher levels of functioning to begin with. The current consensus, though, is that ABA can be extremely helpful for many children with autism. Pavlov, Thorndike, and Skinner's behaviorist ideas were controversial largely because of their resolute belief that external stimuli can account for all learning and their absolute rejection of the involvement of the internal cognitive processes in guiding that learning. As a result, a cognitivist revolution largely replaced behaviorism in the 1960s as the dominant learning paradigm. Rather than focusing only on observable behavior, cognitivism considered inner mental activities such as thinking, memory, knowing, and problem solving. Knowledge was now seen as symbolic mental constructions, representations, or schemas that would need to be created, modified, and accommodated in the process of learning. But simply, for cognitivists, learning is a process of acquiring and storing information. One of the earliest proponents of cognitivism was Edward C. Tolman, whose experiments provided evidence for latent learning, a type of learning that takes place without any corresponding change in behavior. In one experiment, rats were allowed to explore a maze without any reward for 10 days. During these days, there was no detectable change in the rat's behavior, and so, if we define learning in terms of behavior change, there was no learning. But in truth, the rats were learning, and in particular, they were gaining knowledge about how to navigate the maze's corridors. This became obvious on the 11th day, when food was placed in the maze's goal box for the first time. The rats ran to this goal box virtually without error. The knowledge they had acquired earlier now took on motivational significance, so the animals quickly displayed what they had learned. In this case, the knowledge the rats had gained can be understood as a mental map of the maze, an internal representation of spatial layout that indicates what is where and what leads to what. Just as latent learning cannot be explained in the language of behaviorism, with its associations, observed behaviors, and reinforcement schedules, neither can observational learning. Observational learning is a component of Albert Bandura's social cognitive learning theory, which suggests that individuals can learn novel responses by observing the behavior of others. Observational learning does not necessarily require reinforcement, but instead hinges on the presence of others. When people observe a social model performing a behavior and the consequences of that behavior, they remember the sequence of events and use this information to guide subsequent behaviors. Researchers have conducted countless experiments designed to explore observational learning, the earliest of which is the Bobo Doll experiment. In this experiment, Bandura had children individually observe an adult social model interact with a clown doll, Bobo. For one group of children, the adult interacted aggressively with Bobo, punching it, kicking it, throwing it, even hitting it in the face with a toy mallet. Another group of children watched the adult interact with other toys, displaying no aggression toward Bobo. In both instances, the adult left and the children were allowed to interact with Bobo on their own. Bandura found that children exposed to the aggressive social model were significantly more likely to behave aggressively toward Bobo, hitting and kicking him, compared to those exposed to the non-aggressive model. The researchers concluded that the children in the aggressive group used their memory of the adult social model's behavior to determine that aggressive behavior toward Bobo was acceptable. Modern educational practices apply many ideas that grew out of cognitivism. For example, metacognition, or one's thoughts and knowledge about your own thinking, helps individuals evaluate personal knowledge and apply strategies to improve knowledge. This can be achieved, for example, through opportunities for reflection. Similarly, the ability to integrate declarative knowledge, that is, one's encyclopedic knowledge base, into newly learned procedural knowledge, the knowledge relating to performing particular tasks, has been shown to be a powerful approach for durable learning, first described by cognitivists. More generally, cognitivism has contributed many effective classroom strategies for improving attention, memorization, organization, and problem solving. Taking cognitivism a step further, constructivism as a learning paradigm was developed to emphasize that learning is not simply an act of acquiring knowledge and skills, but instead is an active constructive process. Knowledge is constructed based on personal experiences and hypotheses about the environment. In other words, knowledge is a function of how the individual creates meaning from his or her own experiences. Humans create meaning as opposed to simply acquiring it. As you move along the behaviorist, cognitivist, constructivist continuum, the focus of instruction shifts from teaching to learning, from the passive transfer of facts and routines to the active application of ideas to problems. Both cognitivists and constructivists view the learner as being actively involved in the learning process, but the constructivists look at the learner as more than just an active processor of information. The learner elaborates upon and interprets the given information. Meaning is actually created by the learner. The constructivist teacher provides tools with which students formulate and test their ideas, draw conclusions and inferences, and pool and convey their knowledge in a collaborative learning environment. In fact, constructivism taps into and triggers the student's innate curiosity about the world and how things work. A student placed in the hands of a constructivist might be immersed, for example, in an apprenticeship experience. Through the modeling and coaching of experts involved in authentic experiences, the student gains understanding within the true context of an actual problem situation. In the classroom, the constructivist view of learning usually means encouraging students to use active techniques, for example, experiments, real-world problem-solving, projects, and opportunities for discovery. Contrary to criticisms by more conservative and traditional educators, constructivism does not dismiss the active role of the teacher or the value of expert knowledge. Constructivism instead modifies that role, so that teachers help students to construct knowledge rather than reproduce a series of facts. The last learning theory that I'll mention is humanism. Humanism represents a school of thought that suggests learning is a personal act to fulfill one's potential. Humanism focuses on human freedom, dignity, and potential. A central assumption of humanism is that people act with intentionality and values. Researchers have demonstrated that learners can be taught to adopt grit, and doing so will help them maintain effort. Importantly, grit is considered a non-cognitive factor, important for both school and life success. Intrinsically motivating instruction is another humanist approach to learning. A contemporary example of intrinsically motivating instruction is computer gaming software. Computer games provide a player with feedback on progress toward the goal throughout the gameplay. Because the outcome is uncertain, this keeps the player engaged and motivated. When a player is challenged and succeeds through the struggle, their self-esteem can increase as long as the computer game's feedback is constructive and supports learning. An optimal challenge in this context should neither be too difficult nor too easy. Curiosity can also be activated by the aesthetics of a game, its look, sounds, feedback, authentic creation of a world or event, and by presenting opportunities for the player to better their knowledge. When a computer game is designed based on this framework, players are more motivated to play and to learn. Not surprisingly, this has created an interest in gamification, an education design approach that makes use of gaming mechanisms such as badges, points, levels, or leaderboards, and applies these mechanics to the way a course is taught. This, in turn, improves the learner's motivation and also gives learners the freedom to fail and to face and accomplish various challenges and goals. Since gamers willfully spend countless hours on solving the gaming challenges, educators harness learners' motivation in the classroom in unprecedented ways. The distance between behaviorist theories and humanist ones is obviously enormous. Yet, taken together, each of these abstract frameworks can be used to design for diverse instructional situations and the unique needs of individual learners.